What was your childhood like?
Pretty conventional. I was living, raised in part of it, Clarksburg, West Virginia, and had a very calm, cool childhood. My mother was a typical mother. My father did his thing. He made the money, she spent it. But all kidding aside, it was a very pleasant childhood because they did the best they could for us, the parents. Okay?
You should probably start with can you introduce yourself?
I'm Jack O'Brien. I live in East Harwich. I'm a Eastman Kodak. I worked for them for 28 years. And then I joined the Air Force in 1952. And I was with them for 5 years active duty and 15 reserve. That was the time when I started working for Eastman Kodak. So I guess that's about it.
Okay.
Do you work with, you already answered that question. Were you married and did you have any children before you entered the war?
Before what?
You entered the Air Force.
No, I was only 19 years old. And no, I wasn't.
What made you want to be in the military?
Well, it was not so much the military as it was to be a pilot, learn to fly, which I did. And I flew their airplanes for about 20 years. And no combat, but I did fly the Atlantic a number of times. I did fly all over the country, and even got to Japan once.
Really?
lots of traveling.
Did your parents have a reaction, or what was their reaction when you wanted to join?
No problem. They wanted me to get what I wanted, what's best for me. So I pursued that idea, enlisting, becoming an aviation cadet. I got my wings and commission February of 1955.
What did you experience during your serving time?
In the military?
Yep.
when I graduated from cadets and became a pilot and officer, I guess you might say I flew the line, as they call it, or flew to cargo airplanes. I went up to Goose Bay, Labrador. I spent a year in Iceland in air sea rescue, and pretty much conventional, working towards your higher ranking, so that you can make more money, of course. And but I predominantly flew the military air transport service, their particular requirements, their mission, which is hauling people and cargo around the world for the military.
What kind of planes did you fly?
I flew mainly large, I guess you might say, but I should have brought my had some pictures on it. It's out in the car. I flew 4-engine, 2-engine predominantly. A little seaplane time in air commandos. A little bit of. I flew Helio Couriers, which is a small airplane. That was an airplane that was designed to support the special forces, which we're trying to do today. B-25s, C-124s, C-54s, and I could have brought some pictures if I didn't know you wanted it. I would have had them. I apologize.
No, it's okay.
C-119s and Helio Couriers.
What are C-19 or C-119?
The cargo.
Okay.
C-119, I flew the U-10, not the U-10, but Cessna push-pull. They have an engine in the front, an engine in the back, and mm-hmm. a bunch of rockets on the wings. And you would help the fighter bombers to find the targets and mm-hmm. direct them in.
Okay. So,
did anything ever go wrong on the planes? Or?
Yeah, one night I was going down to El Paso, Biggs Air Force Base. I had an engine quit on a B-25. And we took a little bit of time to get there because we were a lot slower.
Mm-hmm.
The one engine that was remaining was keeping us up, but if it ever quit, that's it. But I flew that single engine into El Paso, and I had a couple of other small incidents, but that's the only major one. We got the airplane on the ground, one piece. You could use it again the next day. Once they changed the bad engine. B-25 was used by Jimmy Doolittle to bomb Tokyo. I don't know if you read about that or not.
No.
April 18th, 1942. 16 airplanes took. Are you familiar with this?
No.
You had 16 B-25s took off from a carrier 600 miles from Tokyo.
Mm-hmm.
And they all got off. They lost two, I think, and they landed, crash landed various places in China. One went to Russia,
mm-hmm.
and the Russians tried to give them a hard time, which they did. They couldn't get home for quite a bit of time, but they were finally able to get into the American embassy. I think it was in Tehran, and they had the opportunity to get back to the United States and do what they wanted to do as far as
mm-hmm.
supporting the war effort. But
were there any injuries that
had
happened?
Never
had
that happen to me. Thank goodness.
What was the type of food that you ate when you were there?
The what?
The type of food.
Oh, in the military, pretty conventional. You had my first meal was I enlisted 1952, went to Sampson Air Force Base in near Geneva, New York, where I happened to live, which is,
mm-hmm.
I knew what was going on partially.
Mm-hmm.
And had the first meal was what they called chipped beef on toast and with gravy. It was pretty good,
mm-hmm.
strangely enough. Food was generally good in the military, I think.
Yeah.
And when I became an officer, I'd go to the officers' club and eat for a buck and a quarter. It was pretty good. Yeah, the military is a pretty good place for decent food, accommodations, medical care.
Yeah.
And they're making a lot more money now than they did then. I was making $23 a month or something like that.
Really?
As an aviation cadet. When I got out of the cadet program and graduated, I got a raise to $327 a month.
Yeah.
But then I had a car payment. So anyway, the accommodations, the rooms were very comfortable. You have good medical. And like I said, I have no complaints. I had a good 5 years active, 15 reserve, and I flew all that time, which I wanted.
Nice.
What was your training like?
Very challenging. I flew three or four different airplanes. We flew them. First of all, I went to Moultrie, Georgia, and flew a Piper Cub type airplane. What they're doing there, they're seeing if you can have some sort of skill or talent, and they want to weed out the ones that didn't have the right
mm-hmm.
attitude or ability physically to fly.
Mm-hmm.
I was getting airsick all the time, so I conquered that, and continued. It took me quite a few rides, but they stuck with me.
What were some of the things that like would be like something that you had that you couldn't fly with? Like, maybe some like the things that you had that
What's that?
You got a disability or something that you had that made it so you couldn't fly? Like, what were some of the weaknesses that you had to have so that you couldn't
What
fly?
do you, I'm not quite clear, Scott.
Like, some of, like, the weaknesses that maybe you had that made
Oh,
it
the
so you
air
couldn't fly?
sickness? A lot of people had air sickness. It's like car sick. You get nauseated, and if you don't try to do something about it, you probably end up vomiting and becoming very uncomfortable. Which I was able to beat it, but some people couldn't. As far as any other problems, I can't say I had that many. No.
Did you get trained to drive specific planes?
Oh yeah.
Or ride?
Yeah. We started out, as I said, started Piper Cubs. Then I went to T-6, which is a larger, more powerful airplane. Flew that, and that completed my primary phase. Then I went to another place and flew the T-28, which is a single-engine advanced airplane, and the B-25, which was used in World War II. They built 15,000 B-25s for World War II, and they still have about 40 of them around. Once I got out of cadets, I flew the C-124, which is about the size, a little bit smaller than a 747, but it's propeller, not jet. And then I went over to Iceland for a year and flew the C-54, which is a four-engine DC-4. Then I went to the Air National Guard, retired, went with Kodak, and when all was said and done, I retired from the National Guard and retired from Kodak, and here I am.
Did you ever find a plane the most difficult, like any of them, or did you all find them the same?
Oh, there were, with you, when you get to a four-engine airplane, you might say you're flying with a committee. But you'd have pilot, co-pilot, flight engineer. And back then, you'd have a navigator and a loadmaster to help load the airplane. It has to be loaded carefully for weight and balance. So anyway, it worked out okay. As I say, you fly these bigger airplanes with a committee. The other thing, too, is when I got to some of the smaller airplanes I flew after I'd been around a while, the U-10, which is a six-place helio courier, can land on very short fields. It's used by the air commandos. And then I also flew the 337, which is the push-pull airplane used for target marking.
Okay.
What happened after your service?
Well, let's see, got out, and I ended up working for Eastman Kodak, I guess. Did that for 28 years.
And what's that? The Eastman Kodak?
Eastman Kodak Company. You ever hear of them? They used to have 110,000 people working for them.
Really?
Until the digital camera came out, which was invented by Eastman Kodak. So Eastman Kodak was a very famous company. George Eastman created it, and he also encouraged development of new products, and he did a lot of that. So it's like General Motors is today. Eastman Kodak back then, 110,000 people, 40,000 worked in Rochester, New York. That's not what we're here to talk about, but I went with Kodak. I was very well served.
Do you think that it was better to be serving in the military than working at your old job before?
No, I didn't have an old job. I got out of high school and enlisted in the Air Force.
Or the Eastman Kodak?
Oh, Kodak was
yeah,
after
Kodak.
That. Yeah.
Do you think that being in the military was better than being in that job?
I was trying to go with the airlines. And yeah, it would have been better if I could have made it with the job with the airlines, but I didn't, and it was okay. The military was good, and so was Kodak.
Did you, or are you still in contact with anyone from when you served?
And once in a while, I talk to my old boss and friends that I worked with in Kodak, and there's also some fellows that I flew with that I still hear from. Keep in touch.
That's good.
How did you feel when your service had ended and you were not going to serve anymore? Were you treated any differently?
No. You're still friends, but if they're busy with their flying duties and you can't fly anymore, there's no contact. You'll still be in touch with each other, but you won't fly together as much.
Yeah.
Were your parents proud?
Yeah. My mother and dad came down to see me graduate in Lubbock, Texas. It's a long way from Geneva, New York.
This is going to sound a little harsh, but what was one of your darkest memories of being in the service?
There was no bad things. I'd say that night I lost the engine, I was down over the mountains in New Mexico, and I had to find out where they were, and we didn't have a good chart to do that with. So we were fortunate. We were able to stay clear. It was a good, clear night, so we could see where we were going.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't have to fly IFR. That's instrument flight rules. Excuse me.
What was going through your head when you were going to that moment? What was going through your head when you were in that moment?
I had the problem?
Yeah.
It's kind of strange. I just took it for granted. Mm-hmm. And I did what was necessary to maintain safe flying positions and get to where we could land, and that's it. Everything worked out. I landed at El Paso. The two civilians I had in the back were very happy. They got it on the ground in one piece.
Were you ever completely comfortable flying alone?
Yeah, all the time. Some people aren't. But they still want to fly.
Yeah.
I've never had a real problem with flying. I'm not afraid of it. I'm careful with it.
Mm-hmm.
You have to respect what you're trying to do and act accordingly with good procedures. Yeah, I have no problem.
Have you ever flown ever since?
Oh yeah, I flew. I got my when I graduated, retired, I should say, from Eastman Kodak. I became an instructor pilot because I wanted something to do.
Mm-hmm.
So. I had about 3,000 hours military, and then became a flight instructor, and ended up another 5,000 hours.
Nice.
It was a lot of fun, a lot of enjoyment. I met a lot of good people.
Mm-hmm.
To teach somebody to fly is a challenge.
Yeah,
not everybody can do it.
Mm-hmm.
What skills did you learn?
The smoothest pilots I've ever seen are ladies, women.
What skills did you learn that you still use today?
Oh, the ability to talk to people, I think. Be able to help them out with their problems when they're having difficulty flying with certain maneuvers. And I also did a lot of selling for Kodak. I sold printing products.
How long are you a flight instructor?
How long?
Are you? Yeah.
Well, I'd still be one today if
really?
My medical
mm-hmm.
was good, but it isn't. I have a little heart problem, and I also have the air sickness. No, the air sickness isn't there. I'm sorry, that's incorrect. What else was it? Oh, I have Parkinson's.
Mm-hmm.
I forget about it sometimes. That's why I use a cane. And Parkinson's is, you can keep it under control to a point, but there's no end to it, which is a little difficult, but somehow we function.
If you could go back in time, would you have done anything differently?
I think that I would have probably pursued the airlines a little stronger, but even so, the airlines doesn't have the activities that the military has.
Mm-hmm.
With an airline, you take off, you fly to the next point and land. Military, you can do other different things, support ground troops or what have you.
What was your relationship with colleagues?
With who?
Colleagues. Like your fellow people who you worked with.
Oh, the fellows?
Yeah.
It's okay. Never had any problems. I had problems, but you could always work through them.
What did you miss the most about the military when you left?
The people. I met some good folks there. I also had a lot of interesting assignments flying. That was always enjoyable.
Mm-hmm.
It was a good life.
Yeah.
Sometimes I wish I stayed, other times I'm glad I didn't.
What was your happiest memory?
The military?
Yeah.
I'd say the day I got my wings in commission. And I went on to other things in the military.
Did that completely affect everything that you...
Beg your pardon?
Did that affect everything when you got those?
Well, you behaved accordingly. You lived by certain standards in the military. This just happened by... you just had a case of... You got to obey the various regulations and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not major problems. Yeah, it's just good human relations skills and obeying. If you get an order in the military, it's an order. You got to follow it.
Where were you stationed?
When I got out of cadets, I went to Westover Air Force Base in Delaware. A couple months later, I got assigned to Keflavik, Iceland. I was there for a year. And then I came back and spent another year at Dayton, Ohio. I'm trying to remember all this. And I flew a lot of different airplanes there. I was in flight test, and from there I went to, I told you about Iceland, Dayton, Ohio. I got out, got married, had five children, went over to Eastman Kodak.
What were your children's names?
John, Gil, Tim, Kathleen, and I'm sorry, wrong. I'm thinking of my granddaughter. what the hell am I thinking of? Cece and Elizabeth.
Okay.
When did you meet your wife?
What?
When did you meet your wife?
I met my wife when she was 16 and I was 20, I think. And that's in 33, born in 33, born 53. That would be 1953, I think, in Rochester, New York.
Okay.
That's my first wife.
If I said I was going to join the military, what would you say to that?
You want to join the military?
Yeah. What is some advice that you give people?
Well, I think you ought to find out what you want to do. See what the military can do to satisfy those requirements in your mind.
Mm-hmm.
The military, there used to be a major problem with the misogynistic men who have no respect for women. I mean, that's not right.
Mm-hmm.
Make sure that you should, if you do decide to take a look at them, talk to the recruiting sergeant. Some of these guys are pretty sharp.
Mm-hmm.
But if you wanted to join the military, I've flown with military pilots, women, not women, I'm sorry, but they were very, very good. And a lot of military pilots now are retiring, and they're retiring as colonels and generals, brigadier generals. And they have the same exact requirements, and they also have the same problem, the same I'm sorry, the ability to choose what they want to do with the military. You can change your job if you want to. If you want to become a pilot, you have to apply for the various programs and so on. But that's easily done because they should listen to you.
Mm-hmm.
Now, right now, there's a real problem. The pilot shortage is beginning to make itself felt. The airlines need pilots bad, so does the military. If you want to become a combat pilot, like if the Thunderbirds are one of the major performers there, the lady, she's a lieutenant colonel, makes about 50, 60, 70,000 a year, something like that. Anyway, go ahead.
When you had your first wife, where did you guys live?
Rochester, New York, Auburn, New York. Where else did I go? And then I went with Kodak, lived in Rochester again for training, and then went to Atlanta, Baltimore, Rochester, Boston.
Mm-hmm.
We lived in all those places.
How many wives do you have? Or did you have?
Well, let's leave that out of this.
Oh, okay. So did you have all your kids with one of your wives?
They weren't.
Did you have all of your kids with one of your wives?
First wife, yes.
Your first wife?
Yeah. I wouldn't include that stuff. You're interested in the military.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Why'd you come to Cape Cod?
I always wanted to live here. We used to come here on business assignments.
Mm-hmm.
My boss has a place here. So I still see him. He's retired too. That's a few years ago.
Have you always wanted to live here since you were a kid?
No, I'm not. I always wanted to live here once I visited here a couple of times.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy I worked for at the time made it possible because he was able to get me transferred to Duxbury, Boston. And that was when I retired here. Bought a house here. I went through the usual ways and means of getting a residence.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. How old were you when you moved down here?
92. That would be, right now I'm 84. Let me get a pencil. Mine is gone.
92?
92 would be, I think, 60 years, wouldn't it?
Were you 8, and then it'd be 25. Oh, it's 2018. It would be 26 years ago. 1992 would be.
Yeah. Okay. No, that'd be no. That was 92. 33. I went with Kodak in 62.
Okay.
That's what you have to think about.
Okay.
We should have. So that would be 60, and then I retired, that would be 60, and then that was it. Was that your question again? I'm sorry.
Oh yeah, that was fine. Did you continue to work for Kodak when you moved down here, or? Did you continue to work for Kodak?
When I got moved here from Kodak, yes. And then I retired here. And that's about it. Yeah.
Okay.
Were you the most happy living here?
Yeah.
Out of all your places?
Beg your pardon?
Out of all your places that you lived, you were most happy living on Cape Cod?
I'd say yes. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Is that it?
Yeah, thank you.
We should have talked before.
Mm-hmm.
Then I could have brought maybe some photographs or given you some idea.
Mm-hmm.
So, that's good. Okay. How many of these do you have to do?
Just this one.